Is liberty dying where you live? Escape to Keene at freekeene.com.
Charges, the accidents that happened with those weapons was numerous. And in fact, the hardest letters I wrote home, dear Mr. and Mrs. Blank, I regret to inform your son, Blank, died during combat operations in the name of this country, Republic of Vietnam. I wanted to put a P.S. on the break. By the way, he shot himself in a deep depression when he was high. I didn't do that. If you allow the students on UNH campus to have weapons in their rooms, you're going to create dorms full of rooms. My barracks were full of trained GIs, and they would shoot and each other. Students with guns in their closets. You can get a party together now in 5 minutes when you go on social media. And people, not just students, come on campus because they want a party. They would be bringing guns too. I am absolutely opposed. It makes no sense at all, except ideological, which is the reason given for the bill in the first place. He thinks every town should have a no. This is different. This is really much different. I will feel much more at risk if those students have guns. My doorstep is a quarter of a mile from the center of the New Orleans campus. My grandchildren live right next to campus. My daughter and her husband work on campus. You will put them at risk if you allow this bill to pass. You will. And it's your responsibility to look after the citizen safety in my town and other towns in this unique circumstance. For 13,000 young people who drink, smoke dope, and have their wonderful students, and you stick some guns in there, you better be kidding. One last story. A staff member of mine, a mother, called me one day and she said, Wayne, my son is in jail in Iraq because he shot and killed his best friend. He came back from a patrol, took an AR-15 out of the rifle rack that was supposed to be for clean weapons. He sat down with his friends, they were fooling around, they had a few beers. He pointed the AR-15 at his friend, pulled the trigger, and was around in the chamber to blow his head off. The Marines charged him with murder. I intervened with a lawyer, and we made it aggravated assault, something like that. This is a trained Marines now. You're going to give these guns to untrained students in their dorms, in the closets. I agree with the town council. I agree with both police chiefs in Durham. Leave us alone. This policy's been in place a long time, and we're much safer for it. Do not pass this bill and put the citizens of Durham and the students of Durham at risk. Thank you very much for your time.
Representative Walsh.
Yes, Representative Burton, kind of a two-time question here. A while back, I went up to Plymouth State University to talk about the Second Amendment. While I was there, they showed me the gun locker, because some of the out-of-state students like to hunt, and they have a place where they can store their hunting weapons. Does UNH have any such device?
I have no idea. What's the second part? Is it a two-part question?
Well, do you think it would be harmful if they did?
No. If it's locked like the ROTC, I went through ROTC. We had gun lockers. They're locked up and secure. They're not in the dorm room with your students in a pistol and a bureau. For anyone, come and take it and play with it and shoot something. When I was president of college, the largest gang area in Lynn, my cops didn't, because they're more apt to shoot themselves. The reason they're safe in Durham, and my kids are safe on the campus in Lynn, was I had security people. I had the Lynn PD, but the substation right next to campus. And there are very few places on the UNH campus that won't have a security person right nearby if it's needed, if they're needed. The chances of an active shooter or an incident like you've heard about, which I feel badly about, is far less than if all the students, if the students are allowed to have guns, that there'll be an accident, a fatal accident. And that's the way I believe it, the town council of Durham believes it, the police chief believes it, the citizens of Durham. Thank you.
See no further questions. Thank you very much. The dynamic duo of Paul Dean and John Stevens. You have to understand, I know both of these gentlemen relatively well.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Paul Dean, and I am the Chief of Police of the University of New Hampshire Police Department, responsible for not only the campus in Durham, but for the campuses in Manchester and Concord. This morning, I come before you to oppose this bill. I've heard people talking before, and I want to answer some of your questions. The University of New Hampshire's policy does allow for the storage of firearms at the University Police Department. Currently, I have approximately 40 firearms stored at the department. The firearms are stored there because, in fact, we do allow hunting in our outskirts of our campus, and in fact, I hunt with some of those students. I've had a gun in my hand since I was a young lad. I've come from a hunting family, a Second Amendment family, and those who support that. I also have a son at the University of New Hampshire. I cannot, in good conscience, support a complete campus allowed to have guns in their dormitories, in their classrooms, and in the buildings. You heard some testimony before about what goes on there on the weekends. I would encourage any of you who wish to get in a police car with one of my police officers on a Friday, Saturday night to come sit with us and see firsthand. There's alcohol, there's drugs, and more importantly, there are mistakes and errors made that sometimes they can't walk back from. Additionally, some of the things that have concerned me that is disturbing is that the increase in mental health issues at the university with young students. Last semester alone, 62 university students were seen by the behavioral intervention team, which I'm a part of, for suicidal ideations. Many of those went to Portsmouth, to the pavilion, for service. I'm concerned that if we have firearms inside our dormitories, how are we going to control them being secure? How are we going to control them on a weekend night or any night that somebody comes back, is intoxicated, breaks up with a girlfriend, has some other issue, that they may grab that weapon, whether it's their roommate. In some of these rooms, there are four people to a room, and use that. They already take knives and edged weapons to sometimes attempt suicide. The University Police Department is a full-service agency. We're nationally accredited by two national accredited bodies. We're the only ones in New England to have that distinction. My police officers are highly trained. We train an active shooter. Our patrol deployments, we have police officers everywhere, much like you heard from Representative Burton. I also know that there is no way for us to know the training of those individuals that are going to receive a firearm. I know in the state that you can go obtain a gun permit. There is no requirement for you to receive any training, and there's no requirement for you to qualify with the firearm that you purchase. As a trained police officer for 31 years, I'm not confident that during an emergency situation that a college student would be able to act appropriately and may enhance the situation by introducing another firearm. I ask that you consider opposing this testimony today for the good of the institutions and allow the institutions to regulate firearms on their campus. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, my name is John Stevens. I'm a retired member of the New Hampshire State Police, and since retiring, I have been working with Homeland Security on national threat issues all over the country. I also sit as a member of the Board of Trustees for the Community College System of New Hampshire, and I represent that system here this morning, and I too wish to oppose this bill in regards to allowing weapons on campus. In my position as a member of the Board of Trustees, I chair the Risk and Safety and Risk Management Committee for the college system. This committee works with each institution on a monthly basis. It works with prevention, behavioral intervention teams, and we are confident that although we understand, and certainly as we look at the current state of the media today in regards to what happens around the country, we certainly are not in a position where we can stop every incident from happening. But what we can do is ensure that the campuses, the faculty, the students and the staff are as safe as possible, and we work to that initiative every day. There have been significant amounts of money that have been spent on each of the several campuses throughout New Hampshire in regards to making those institutions safe and secure. It is also important that each of those institutions work hand in hand with local and state law enforcement to ensure that there is a relationship between those campuses and the law enforcement community if in fact such an incident should take place. We are fearful that if in fact we have a number of students, number of staff, so forth that may be armed on campus, if in fact we should have a critical incident, law enforcement coming into the institution would have a very difficult time discerning the good from the bad. So I sit here before you, along with my counterparts from the University of New Hampshire, to oppose this bill, and certainly would be happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Representative Walsh.
Yes, no other firearm, particularly handguns, are mostly used for defending oneself. In the absence of firearms at the university, are the students allowed to carry mace?
Each of the institutions from the community college system, each campus has its own policies and procedures and regulations. If in fact a student was to be carrying mace, I would expect that each president from that campus would be involved in that decision as to whether that would be allowed. But certainly those decisions are made up individually at each of the campuses.
All right, thank you. Representative Martin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for your testimony. My question is quite simple. If with all the rules and prohibitions in place, some student decides to ignore them all, which is usually what happens, who's the first line of defense? If an ARC student decides he's going to ignore the rules and create some heinous little situation, who is the first line of defense?
I'll speak for the University of New Hampshire. I know our response time is under 2 minutes. We constantly do training for our staff there. In fact, I've done 6 programs on civilian response to active shooter for people to save themselves. We're going to respond and we're going to come. There's no evidence that I can find that just because you have a gun that you're going to be able to stop that person if you don't have the training.
On behalf of the community college systems, as I said earlier, each of the colleges have a relationship with local and state law enforcement. There are individuals on staff within those institutions that have been trained and exercised as to what if scenario, if in fact there should be an active shooter on campus. So those protocols would come immediately into place, and local and state law enforcement would be immediately involved.
Just put follow up. You said response time is 2 minutes. How many 16-round magazines could someone empty in 2 minutes?
I don't know the qualifications of the people that you're asking me to address that with, or whether or not they're going to function that way in an emergency situation.
Talking about the shooter.
Representative Barnes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and gentlemen, thank you for taking my question, although I guess that this is directed more towards UNH. Can you give me any idea how many violent interactions there are between students on the campus in the course of the school year?
Well, there's a lot of fights. There's it usually involves alcohol. The average, I would say, at least 10 to 15 second degree or first degree assaults throughout the community. during the school year. It does vary from year to year. Some are higher, some are lower.
Follow up.
Not a follow-up, it'd be a new question.
but
I have somebody else in front of you. I'll get to you as soon as I run down the list. Representative Berube.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for taking my question. My question's more or less been answered already on how many incidents have taken place where it would have been beneficial to have a student have a weapon, especially if they weren't qualified to use it. Would you believe?
I'm just speaking on behalf of the community college system. Once again, the behavior intervention teams work hand in hand with staffs and the student population. Hopefully, what would happen is that prior to anything like that taking place, an individual would be recognized as to having some sort of individual problem. And those things would be addressed, hopefully, before that would take place.
I want to thank you for your answer. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Representative Burke.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I guess it's to the officer is where my question. I've heard from several people testify, and almost everyone that sits there is saying how much drugs and alcohol are at UNH. Do you have any idea how much drugs are at UNH?
I don't have the statistics in front of me. I can tell you that we do deal with that problem on a regular basis, and it's pretty steady.
Follow up, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And are drugs still illegal in New Hampshire?
Yes, sir.
Even at UNH?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Representative Robertson.
Thank you. In those violent situations, is there ever a case where you think a gun in the pocket of one or the other, or both, would have improved the situation?
Based on my knowledge of those situations, they usually involve people who are intoxicated and they're fighting over what I would consider meaningless things once the investigation is done. I think that a gun in a spur of the moment may cause unintended consequences that weren't intended by those individuals.
Thank you. I see no further questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
David Ferranto.
Good morning, committee. If I could approach, was it?
Sure.
I'll be real brief because I don't want to rehash. I would be talking about the same issues that the chief and Mr. Stevens have talked about previous, as well as Representative Burton. The Department of Safety opposes this bill as well for all the reasons listed. Just real briefly, personal knowledge at UNH, Plymouth, and Keene. I was on the special events response team for many years where I'm sure most of you are aware of the riots that take place, particularly during sports win events, i.e. Celtics, Red Sox, Patriots. There were occasions there where cars were being flipped over, burnt, light poles being knocked down, the crowds just drink to the point of passing out. Fights ensued, melees ensued. We were tasked with working with the university police and the Durham police and the other campus police departments in trying to quell those disturbances. So as Chief Dean has already pointed out, you add a firearm into the mix of drunk students out there. They're not thinking clearly, they're impaired by alcohol. Something as simple as somebody pulling out a gun and firing it into the air to celebrate, trying to hit a light pole like, break the glass. I mean, there's all these unintended consequences. So I won't belabor that point any further. One thing that the Department of Safety would question on this bill would be the wording of prohibited prohibition on institution or entity funded by the state of New Hampshire. An entity funded by the state of New Hampshire, I don't know if the intent of this bill was solely restricted to colleges and universities, but a funded entity by the state would be the New Hampshire State Hospital, State Prison, the Sununu Center, all of the detention facilities that are funded by the state. So if the wording of entity is any entity funded by the state, that would appear to disallow people going to the state hospital and carrying a firearm, whether it's a visitor or someone else that has some mental deficiencies, going to visit a person in that state hospital. So we wanted to express our concern on the wording of that. Perhaps it wasn't the intention of that, but that's how it reads in the proposed bill here. That's all I have. I can take questions.
Representative Welch.
Yes. In your testimony, I don't know, my eyes are not working. You made a comment in here about terrorists. However, it would even more likely lead to the facilitating unstable persons and terrorists bringing firearms on campus, etc. It's my understanding that terrorists in particular look for gun-free zones. And I think maybe you didn't mean to imply that a gun-free zone is a safe place.
The intent of that would be if there was no ban on firearms at the university, then if there was a student that would go to that school and infiltrate that school, he could simply walk in without a weapon, without any type of screening.
Follow up. I understand that. I just kind of felt the way it was used in your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks, Major, for coming. This is directed to you and the Chief. Since Columbine, I know in my own experience with Portsmouth, we changed the response times to an active shooter rather than staging and waiting for SWAT to come, as what happened in Columbine, 2 hours. Now the police go right in. Would you say that state police and most university police departments and local jurisdictions share that same philosophy to actually truncate the response time to 2 minutes or less to go in on an active shooter? Has that been your experience in the last 15 years?
Yes, sir. We've all trained actively in the active shooter program. We've actually used schools in the dorm area to practice in every summer. We work with the local police, the university police. Every trooper is equipped with an assault rifle and proper vest, and they're required to go after the threat as soon as upon arrival as they can be. The idea is to go in and stop the shooting as quick as possible. And the nearest trooper or police officer will, in fact, or should, in fact, do that.
Thank you.
See no further questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Alan Rice.
Just a second.
Major,
the representative has a question. Yeah.
Just kind of a two-part question. Sorry, I should have come up with it sooner. Isn't it true that most active terrorist-related type shooters come to the scene wearing some kind of protective clothing? Is that generally?
On many occasions, yes. I don't know that to be accurate in all cases, but certainly to answer your question, a percentage of them do, yes.
Okay, I'll follow up. And then what kind of weaponry in the hands of perhaps a student, trained or untrained, would be required to effectively stop the person who might be so dressed?
You have to meet force with force, and firearms with firearms. A 22 or a 38 or even a 45 is no match against an assault rifle with some student if the assailant comes in with that type of weaponry. Typically, people that are going to raid a school or going to a school are going to have heavy armament to do so.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now, if you're going to...
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. For the record, my name is Alan Rice, and I am the Vice President and Training Director of the New Hampshire Firearms Coalition. We represent thousands of law-abiding firearms owners, manufacturers, and dealers in the state. And I'm also here on behalf of our partners at Gun Owners of America, which is a national organization representing the interests of firearms owners in all 50 states. We are very supportive of House Bill 1314. Some of you were in the legislature over 10 years ago when preemption was originally passed. This statute, when it was debated extensively in this committee, the intent and the goal of the statute was that this body, the General Court, is the only body in the state of New Hampshire with the authority to regulate firearms. There was a lot of back and forth on it, and that was what was in the testimony, that was discussed, and that was the intent of the bill. We don't believe that the UNH policy applies to anybody other than students and faculty, and it's at their peril. And what I mean by that is if a student is caught with a firearm, that person can be expelled, a faculty member can be unemployed, but any of us carrying a gun in or around the campus, there are no criminal penalties. It's not a crime. It's not outlined in the firearms laws in 159. It's not outlined in the criminal code. It's a policy. We believe the policy is an unlawful policy and contradictory to the preemption law. And I don't say that lightly. You've run it by several attorneys. And the university has a police department. They receive state money. They have a board of governors. They're governed similar to a town. The preemption law very much applies to them. We're not conceding that it doesn't. We're supporting the bill because it'll add clarity and it will make it clear that it absolutely does apply. This body saw fit to allow the carrying of firearms in this building and the state house across the street. We haven't had any problems. I'm sure I would have heard about it. I'm in touch with a lot of legislators on a regular basis, and they know where I stand, and they would have told me if there was a problem. People tend to act responsibly. What I like to tell people when I teach is that the gun tends to have the opposite of what my opponents characterize. The gun is the leveler of emotion. When you realize that you have a firearm and you can respond with lethal force, most people, all people that I've encountered, will take a step back and think about it, and they don't let the adrenaline and the emotions kick over. They make the brain kick in because they know the awesome power of the firearm. It is the level of all emotions. State agencies have been prohibited from banning guns in their building. Signs have been taken down over the years. It's something that we've fought and written letters and gotten in touch with governor and council as many times as we needed to have those signs come down. The colleges, universities, the hospitals, any way you want to word it, you want to use the formal wording in the language, in the bill, or where you want to use, you know, the slang terms that we throw around. Either way, you don't lose your Second Amendment civil rights because you go to one of these places, especially after this body has seen fit to preempt cities and towns and counties from regulating firearms. Accordingly, I would urge this committee to vote House Bill 1314 ought to pass without any amendments, and I will take any questions that the members may have, and I thank you.
Representative Padalakis.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Rice, for taking my question. I got two questions. I'd like to clarify you saying that everybody agreed to guns in the Representative Hall. That was a party issue and a policy.
And I really don't want to hear if you, would you believe?
Would you believe,
we're
okay.
We're having far too many would you believe questions that aren't questions.
Okay. The USA and the gun owners, all the gun owners in the state of New Hampshire are willing to put guns in the university. Is that clear?
No, it's not what I'm saying, ma'am. I'm saying that my organization says, and our attorneys have reviewed the existing statute, and it doesn't apply. The university policy doesn't trump statute, and we're asking for the change just to add additional clarity. I can't speak for all of the gun owners. I can speak for my board of directors and our members and Gun Owners of America, and we're saying that your Second Amendment rights don't go away if you set foot on a college campus. And what I am saying is, for me to carry a gun onto UNH, it's not a crime. I haven't committed a misdemeanor or a felony by having that gun with me. However, a student doing the same thing risks expulsion if caught, and a faculty member risks unemployment. But it's not a crime. There's no crime committed.
Can I follow up on that?
Follow up.
Is there a policy in the university that says that you can't carry them?
We have had numerous reports. People have emailed us their student handbooks and policies where they say, and the police chief just testified to that they have a policy.
Didn't they accept that policy when they enrolled there?
I'm sorry, ma'am?
Didn't they accept that policy when they enrolled?
I honestly don't know the procedures for enrollment. I don't know what's accepted or declined. I can't speak to that. I've never enrolled there.
Thank you.
Representative Robertson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Knowing how much alcohol is consumed on a weekend on the campus, would you also be for legalizing carrying a gun in a bar?
Well, sir, it's already legal to carry a firearm in a bar.
And you think, follow up, and you think alcohol and guns should mix, although alcohol and cars don't?
I didn't say that. You asked me if it was legal, and I said it was.
But would you recommend it? Would you think the law shouldn't be changed where drinking and carrying should be illegal?
I do believe, sir, that there are criminal statutes that could be used against someone who consumed alcohol and acted irresponsibly with a firearm. But no, sir, we don't believe the mere act of having the firearm could be a crime in and of itself, whether you're in a bar or a restaurant or a campus.
Or drunk.
I see no further questions.
Legally drunk?
Thank you. Would you agree that the concentration of thousands of young people between the age of 18 and 21 creates a kind of a special dynamic that doesn't exist elsewhere in general society?
No, I don't, sir. First of all, those under 21 shouldn't be consuming alcohol, and I'm sure that Chief Dean will address that aggressively when his officers encounter it. That's the first answer. And the second answer is, whether you are in a community of 13,000 or a community of 1,300, you don't lose your constitutional civil rights.
Thanks for not answering my question.
Thought I did.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Elizabeth Woodcock.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For the record, my name is Elizabeth Woodcock. I'm an Assistant Attorney General. I'm here on behalf of the Attorney General's Office, and we oppose the bill. I have written testimony, and as the committee is probably aware, I tend to look at these things as kind of a wordsmith. What this bill would do, although I think that the general gist of the testimony here has been mostly to deal with allowing firearms at the University of New Hampshire, the language goes much further than that. It would prohibit Concord Hospital from preventing people from prohibiting firearms in the hospital. I looked on Concord Hospital's website, and indeed they do tell visitors not to bring guns into the hospital for, I'm sure you can imagine, very good reasons. A number of other hospitals also have that prohibition. The second thing is, and that would not be limited to medical hospitals, it would also be mental health facilities where you would want to make sure that people did not have access to firearms, because that could be absolutely disastrous. In addition, and I think that this is something that you need to think about, the This committee, over the years, and I've been before it many, many times, really takes its responsibility towards protecting the least, the most vulnerable people in the society very carefully. And there are situations in which a vulnerable person could be the victim of firearm violence. We don't have metal detectors at all the places where we might want to have them. But there are situations in which if an angry parent is subject to supervised visitation, it happened about 2 years ago. A father came to supervised visitation at the YMCA, and he pulled out his gun and he killed his son, and then he killed himself. A man came into a hospital in, I think it was Dover. His wife was very ill. He was upset. He posted on Facebook that he didn't go for much for drama, but he was going to have some drama now. And he killed his wife, and then he killed himself. We don't have metal detectors at all of these places. And I remember when the little boy was killed, there was a lot of discussion about whether there should be metal detectors in places where parents are going on supervised visits, and people were concerned and they realized it would be enormously expensive. But what this bill would do is it would tell the YMCA that you can't even tell the people that they're not to come to these visits armed. You can't even tell the person who's coming into the Concord Hospital that we don't want firearms. And if you do that, you will lose your funding from the state. A good example of how this works, last night I came home and I contribute to River Bend, which is a community mental health facility here in the Merrimack, Hampton area. And River Bend gets 33% of its funding from the state of New Hampshire. So what the bill would do is say to River Bend, we don't trust you to make rules and regulations for the people who take advantage of your services, just as it would be saying to Concord Hospital, the medical doctors, the nurses, the administration, the medical personnel, we don't trust you to make decisions for the safety and security of your patients. And therefore, if you make a rule with which we disagree, we will take away your funding. That basically is telling the institution that it can't use its own judgment. The impact to a place like River Bend would be absolutely devastating, I'm sure, to lose 33% of its funding. This is at a time when the state is dealing with enormous problems, providing people with alcohol and drug rehabilitation, mental health support. The threat that is contained in this legislation, I think, is unintended, but it goes much further than simply saying that we think that just students at the University of New Hampshire should be allowed to carry firearms. Whatever the merits are of campus carry, and I do not support that, neither does the Attorney General, but whatever those merits are, this bill goes much further.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you. Thank you, Attorney Woodcock. One quick question. The last, on line 12, nothing in this section shall be construed as affecting a political subdivision's right to adopt zoning ordinances for the purpose of regulating firearms or knives in the same manner as other businesses or take any action. Does that language counteract this amended language?
It doesn't seem to, and I quoted in my written statement, I quoted what RSA 207-59 deals with, and that deals with regulating the management, preservation, protection, propagation, and taking of wildlife in the state.
Okay.
So it's not, there is a specific law that prohibits firearms in a courtroom. And if you think about that, ladies and gentlemen, there are good reasons why you don't want firearms in a courtroom. People very rarely go into court in jolly moods. And I think the same is true in some of these other places, mental health hospitals and facilities, at medical hospitals, places where you are visiting in the case of supervised visitation with your children. those don't bring out the best in people's emotions. And courtrooms are a good example. The courts have been allowed to regulate the carrying firearms because of the separation of powers doctrine. And that was upheld and I quoted the case here. That was upheld some years ago. But to tell the doctors, the medical doctors at Contra Hospital, you have to allow people to come into this facility with firearms, that's just substituting that judgment for the judgment of the medical professionals.
Lynn Martin.
Chairman, thank you for your testimony. You've cited an incident in the hospital, a YMCA, condition at the mental health clinic, Congress Hospital. Do you really think that if we ban firearms in every one of these places, that if someone had an intent to do harm to someone else, a little sticker on the door saying no firearms would deter them at all?
You know, we don't know the answer to that. We know that some people are not deterred by it. We don't know the people who are deterred because nothing happens. I can tell you that sometimes people are deterred from doing things if they think that they will get into trouble. But the problem here is, think about the man who posted on Facebook saying, I never go in for drama on Facebook. He did this a few minutes before he walked into the hospital and shot his wife. Posting on Facebook, he walks into the hospital. The hospital, because it cannot tell him you can't carry a firearm, can't stop him until he's walking in to the woman's hospital room with a firearm ready to kill him. If they could have stopped him at the door, would he have killed him? If they could have, would he have killed him? And if you can't prevent him, how can you stop him?
Follow up. Not to get into an argument, this individual went here and determined he was going to kill his wife and himself. Someone had tried to stop him at the door, would there have been more victims?
We don't know the answer to that because he was determined to kill his wife and himself. He wasn't determined to kill anyone else. Now, I can tell you from a personal experience, I had a friend who was in college who had a firearm, who got depressed. Young people being in the proximity of firearms when they're young and upset that a young lady who was also a friend of mine didn't love this young man the way he hoped. And he pulled this gun out and shot himself at Bowdoin College in 1974. I understand when the people are talking about their concern about young people and firearms and alcohol and depression and all the things that wonderful and terrible things that happen to you between the ages of 18 and 25, that there is a concern. But I also think that this legislation goes far beyond that. And while you can be skeptical that a no firearms insignia on a door doesn't discourage someone, you also don't know when someone goes into a hospital where people are grievously ill if they're the person who will use the firearm. Going in doesn't mean that you necessarily have the intent to use it. The decision of the hospital administration is that firearms are not good things to have in hospitals where people are seriously ill and may be seriously depressed.
Yeah, I just wanted to correct something that you indicated, that firearms in courtrooms. Originally, that was done by a court rule.
That's correct.
And in the year 2000, I put in a bill to put it in statute because I didn't think that the Supreme Court or the Superior Court should be making rules that have the force and effect of law. I just wanted to correct that.
Well, I think the Supreme Court would disagree with you that they can't make laws that have the force and effect of law. I think they do it pretty much on a daily basis. But I understand your point.
I think that the section of in the Constitution that gives them that authority has been under question for some time now, but essentially I just wanted to correct that. Thank you.
Hey, Representative Berube.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for taking my question. Is the university breaking the law right now by not allowing people to carry? Could you expound on that area?
I don't think so. And I understand what I think I understand what the argument of the gentleman who expressed that opinion was, but you have a right to carry a firearm. You do not have a right to go to the University of New Hampshire. You don't have a right to go to the Concord Hospital. Places that are even public places can decide that they want to regulate what people do. For example, I have the right to walk around the streets of Concord with a bottle of soda. I don't have the right to bring it into the Concord Library. The Concord Library doesn't want me spilling my soda on their books, so they make rules and they say you can't do this. But the Concord Library is a public entity and it receives, I'm sure, state money.
Thank you for your answer. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
I don't see any more questions. Thank you very much. It being 12 o'clock, we normally would recess, but because of the number of people that are here, still testify, we're going to work through lunch, and I'm going to recommend that part of the committee go to lunch, come back, and then we'll leave the other part so they can continue the testimony. To that extent, I'm going to turn the chair over to Reverend Leonard Welch to run away and feed my hungry
Will they break out lunch?
No, they're going to continue testimony, but some of the panel will go to lunch.
Go back to the other one at 1 o'clock.
Morning, Mr. Chairman. Members of the Criminal Justice Public Safety Committee, for the record, my name is Al Jones. I live here in Concord. I'm a certified firearms instructor, certified range safety officer, licensed armed guard, and a former accredited shooter. And I'm here this morning to represent the 500 members of the Sunset Mountain Fishing Game Club in strong support of House Bill 1314. I have a prepared testimony here, but a lot of it has been covered, so I'm not going to rehash things that have already been covered, but I would like to repeat that the only people that are going to listen to the little sticker, no law-abiding citizen, the only people that are going to listen to the little sticker on the door that says we've got a free zone are people with criminal intent. It's only going to affect the law-abiding citizens. And I think that the students and staff of these institutions deserve the same safety and protections that the rest of the public enjoys. Any person who's qualified to possess a firearm should be able to do so anywhere else. I think I'm safe in saying that if we try to pass any of the freedoms we get in the Bill of Rights, if anything else other than the Second Amendment, the students would be up in arms. Staff would be up in arms. I'm open to any questions.
Thank you very much for your testimony. It's so good.
Senator Welch, Mike Hill.
Been a long time.
Good to see you. I'm Mitch Popaz. I'm president of the NRA of New Hampshire, also Calvin Fish and Game. NRA of New Hampshire is the NRA affiliate in the state of New Hampshire. I'm a little concerned about the student at UNH. It sounds like a wild party all the time. I think perhaps we should outlaw automobiles on the city campus because all those drunk people driving around. The right to self-defense should be not taken away from university when people go to school. It's a right. Second Amendment right, you have a right to self-defense. I heard of the chief from UNH state that their response time is 2 minutes. And I suggest
that if half the weapons here weren't armed and someone walked in this room with a firearm, we'd all be dead in 2 minutes. So the reality is these individuals, these students, these young people have the right to protect themselves. I don't think they're all out in drunken brawls. I don't think they're all drinking beer and acting crazy. Also, between the ages of 18 and 22, that's not law enforcement, I mean, law enforcement and military. Those are the same people that go to university. They're not all crazy and irresponsible. They have the right to self-defense. Women, in 2 minutes, a lot of bad things can happen to a defenseless woman. You can't defend yourself with a firearm. A firearm is an equalizer. People that carry firearms will do so responsibly. People that commit crimes with firearms should go to jail. That simple. If you have not committed a crime, you shouldn't say, what if, maybe, could happen, this could happen. Currently, there's 9 states that have universities that allow firearms carried by law-abiding citizens. When was the last time you heard about one of those people shooting up Yosemite Sam at a party? It happened. This should happen in New Hampshire. This is a clarification of the rights and the law that, as it currently stands. Grab my glasses for a second. Read the rest of the bill. There was a concern about prisons and other institutions. If you read the bill, it says except as otherwise specified, provided in statute. I'm sure there's somewhere in statute says you can't carry firearms in prison, or we have kinds of crazy riots right now in prison. Okay, I think that's all I have. Everything else has been stated. Again, this is a clarification of the law as it stands, that universities are skirting the law, we believe. That's all I have.
Questions? Representative Green.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for coming. Sure. Do you think the incident at Virginia Tech would have been a lot less damaging if the students were allowed to carry?
Absolutely. Once again, a law-abiding student, and more than 2 million times a year, these incidents are stopped. You don't read about it because it's not news. Nothing happens. But a law-abiding citizen with a firearm is more apt to stop an incident than cause it, than what we're hearing here today. And again, we're suggesting that it's up to law enforcement and doctors and nurses to protect people. It doesn't happen. It's not their job. It's not their responsibility. It's been proven that they are not responsible. And we're responsible to protect ourselves. And it's wrong to take that away from you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for coming
sure.
today. How do you reconcile that with the fact that to a person, the police officials and the state police officials whom we pay, the police professionals, to a person, disagree with this kind of law? And these are people who, like me, carry a firearm a lot. I carry a firearm a lot.
I understand why you put the difficulty. And I think, quite frankly, law enforcement has a particular job, and the job is outlined as it is. And if you told them, what if we get rid of the Fourth Amendment? Would it make the job easier? They'd probably say yes. It'd be nice and easy if they didn't have to get warrants. They believe someone was guilty, they could just walk in and do what they had to do. But we have rights. And part of having rights is responsibility. And you give up some safety when you have those rights. So I think if the Constitution was being written here, you ask law enforcement and say, forget that Fourth Amendment. That's a real pain. We have to go see the judge. We have to get rid of all this. We have to get this right thing. These lawyers involved to get it. So that's why I go to that.
Thank you, Chairman, and thank you for your testimony.
Thank you.
I guess we heard that from the police chief from UNH that his response time is 2 minutes. How many incidents are you aware of that weren't over in less than 2 minutes?
Most of that I've heard are over 2 minutes, unless there's someone held in a room. And I can, anecdotal story of my own. I had a home invasion. And police responded great. They were there in 2 minutes. The incident was over. It was well over within that 2 minutes. I didn't have to shoot anybody. They ran away. You didn't read about it in the paper because I didn't shoot anybody. But it was a firearm that prevented this thing from going bad in my direction. I'm going to tell you. And it probably took me 2 minutes to call them. So you're talking 2 minutes from the time they get the phone call. Again, someone came in this room and stuff, and nobody had firearms. And I know half of you have firearms.
What?
At least. that we would all be dead and someone from the next room. And the response time would be great. I'm not suggesting law enforcement don't do their job well. I'm just saying that we have to protect ourselves within that 2 minute time.
See, no further questions. Thank you very much for your testimony.
Thank you much.
Diane Freeman.
Good afternoon. I'm Ian Freeman from Keene, one of the co-chairmen of the New Hampshire Liberty Party. Just wanted to address a few of the things that have come up so far in the hearing today. I've heard a lot of fear mongering on the part of the people who oppose this legislation. Lots of scary what-ifs about what might happen. I think some of you have addressed appropriately that even if you do prohibit things, people who are willing to break the law will go ahead and break the law. But further, what about the fear of the college ladies who might be afraid of being sexually assaulted on their campus? They have no way of defending themselves. You saw the college representatives couldn't really come right out and answer the question straightforward to say that they can't even carry pepper spray on the college campus. So you want to talk about fear, I imagine some of those young ladies are pretty scared on a regular basis. Further, a lot of the arguments, these fear-mongering arguments that you've heard here today by these people, some of those who have been testifying against this bill, are all arguments that can be used against carrying guns anywhere. Well, there's scary people everywhere who might do terrible things. And so therefore, no one should be able to carry guns. We should have metal detectors at the entrance of every building. And I think most people would see that as ridiculous in the state of New Hampshire, which is supposedly the live free or die state, where historically New Hampshire has had a lot more gun freedom than other states. And what do you know, New Hampshire is also the safest of all of the states. I believe I've seen statistics recently showing that New Hampshire has the lowest of all 50 states murder rates, meaning very, very few murders happen here. And I would argue that's because we have relative gun freedom, that we can protect ourselves, except in certain places, and that's what needs to change. It's my understanding that, from what I've heard in the testimony, that there is no actual law prohibiting someone from carrying a gun onto a college campus, but there is an open court order against a group of activists. I believe it was the Grafton Circuit, the Grafton District Court issued an order, a temporary restraining order, back in 2011 when a former police officer and a former military member had planned to have an open carry protest on Plymouth State College campus. And the judge came out with a temporary restraining order enjoining those individuals and any of their agents, associates, or basically anyone who could be proved to be connected to them in some way, were also prohibited by the judge's order from having a gun on the college campus. So if they were to go onto the college campus, as it was their plan to do, and do, you know, engage in this protest, then they could be arrested for contempt of court. And of course, as you may know, contempt of court is not a statute, it is a power of the court system where a man who is a judge can issue any amount of time in jail if someone violates his order. So if the person were to go on that college campus, if I were, for instance, to go on that college campus and in protest, I could be arrested because I knew the two gentlemen that were involved in this temporary restraining order. And then the judge could sentence me to 6 months in jail with no trial whatsoever, and there would be no accountability for that judge. So even though it may not be illegal per se, it is still something that could get someone put into a jail cell. Further, if the school or whatever the entity, the institution is being discussed here, is receiving public funds, if it's receiving money from the government, then it should be subject to respecting people's rights. If the school's private, then I believe in private property. And if a private property owner, whether it's a bar owner or a school owner, if they're not taking money from the state, then I believe they should be able to set their rules. If they don't want to allow guns on campus, that should be their that should be their prerogative. And I believe there are some bars and other private businesses in New Hampshire who do prohibit the carrying of firearms on their private property. And each individual person who goes into that private business would be able to decide whether or not to patronize that business. So if the state would like to cut off all of the funding of the schools, and then the schools were to become truly private organizations, and then they wanted to prohibit firearms or whatever else, then I wouldn't have any objection to that. But as long as they're receiving public money, then people's rights need to be respected there. That's all I've got to say about that.
Any questions? Thank you very much for your testimony.
Thank you.
Chair calls Alan Gagin.
Yeah,
your
handwriting
is like mine.
You know where I get the worst it gets. Members of the committee and gallery, thank you for hearing me. I've heard a lot of testimony here today. I'm not going to go into a lot of it. But I understand what the chief of police for UNH was saying about the parties on UNH. And I wouldn't give a gun to a student either, but I've been using and had firearms since I was 8 years old. I haven't killed anybody yet, but that was because I was in the military. My thinking is, as the gentleman had just spoke, if I went up to Plymouth State College, or UNH, or Keene State College, they could, effectively the way I understand it now, they could tell me to get off campus. If I'm there on legitimate business, let's say I'm there for a graduation, I'm not doing anybody any harm. And I'm not representing anybody but myself, just to be clear. But I do know I go to several places in the state, one in particular, that makes me feel like a target. And that's the VA Medical Center in Manchester. I go there about once a year for a physical. Big sign on the door, no firearms allowed. Now, yeah, it's at the VA. And I'm thinking, okay, I'm here in the VA. They have security, and I've seen it. One officer from the Manchester Police Department who carries a sidearm. But if he's in the far end of the facility and a deranged individual comes in the front door of the lobby and starts shooting, by the time he gets there, it's going to take him 5 or 10 minutes. I find that abhorrent. If I was there with my sidearm and I was in the lobby, I'd make a quick end of this threat. But I can't. Because I'm a responsible gun owner. I'm going to observe that sign at peril to myself. And it's the same way with college campuses. Any school. The school is safer if I, as a private citizen, be that Timberlane High School, be that Laconia High School, where I went to school. We used to have guns in school, for crying out loud. We used to have shooting clubs. Nobody got hurt. No mass shootings in those days. But the point is, the schools are safer if I go in to visit the school and ask about curriculum. I got grandkids in school. Maybe I want to go in and see one of their classes. The school is safer if I'm there because the resource officer may not be there when that deranged individual comes in. But I wish this bill would expand to all schools because a law-abiding citizen going in with a licensed firearm, or if he wants to open carry, if he doesn't have a license, there's no harm. I've never seen any harm. I've been carrying since 9/11. I would rather err on the side of caution than be another statistic. And that's all I have to say. Any questions?
Thank you very much for your testimony.
Okay. Thank you.
Danny Dean.
Those of you who don't know me, my name is Penny Dean. I'm an attorney licensed in Maine, New Hampshire, Massachusetts, and admitted to several other courts as well. And I respectfully direct all of you to look at the Clery Act. It's the Jean Clery Act. It's Disclosure of Campus Security and Campus Crime Statistics Act. It was passed in 1990. It's at 20 U.S.C. Section 1092, subsection F. And here's the reason I would respectfully suggest you look at that. It took Congress passing an act to make universities disclose crime on campus. And it's one of the most unreported things. And we're talking all sorts of crime across the country. And because of that, there's been several allegations over the years of different universities underreporting crime, because now that they have to report it, parents can look at that and make that as part of the decision when they're deciding where to send their children to school. And I think it's important to look at that. There is a particular entity called the American School Search Safety Committee, and they have a crime and safety study. And the University of New Hampshire got an F because there were 50, according to them, and they say it's based on data from 2011 to 2013, 50 forcible sex offenses on campus during that time frame. And so when you heard the police chief Dean, which is absolutely no relationship to me, say they have a 2-minute response time, that's great. If you can get to a phone 2 minutes, that's great. I don't think a lot of these women who are being raped could get to a phone, or I bet you a nickel they probably would have called for help. But I think what's more important is you have to look at just the right to defend yourself. It's wonderful if you can call police, but I would like the ability to defend myself and to make my own determinations. And I think rape is one of the most horrible crimes that lives with me for life. And it's a vastly underreported crime. And so you have to look at that and other crimes and say, wait a minute, if these kids chose to go to some other place, they don't just live at the campus at the university 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Those same students go out and have parties other places, and we haven't heard about shoot-ups at the OK Corral and all sorts of off-campus places. Like anyone else, they'd be subject to criminal charges for misbehaving. But I think you as this committee and as a legislative body need to look at the fact when you are determining where to send tax dollars, do you want to support any university who can take away from their employees the right to self-defense? They have to choose every day, do I risk my job or do I carry a firearm to work? And when one gal said in the newspaper one time, and I read this statement over and over in my head, is you have to be alive to be fired. And she chose to defend herself at her particular job, and she was fired. And so you have to look at, you're making those people make that choice every day. And to answer a few questions, there are administrative regs in place currently that prohibit carry firearms on prison property. Places like the hospitals and the New Hampshire State Hospital, you should be able to carry firearms. People who are visiting them should not have their rights taken away. The people who are in there are already barred from firearm ownership, firearm use. They can't even possess firearms. So you're talking about things that really make no sense whatsoever. You know, they talk about a security officer nearby at the campus. We might want to tell those 50 women about the security officer at UNH. Maybe he could have saved them. They must not know about this wonderful security officer that's nearby. And I think you have to look at a couple of things. I heard one person say there's no evidence that a firearm will stop crime, and that's absolutely not true. There's three great academics who have been around for decades. One is Gary Klett, he's out of the University of Florida. And he's written many, many bits of research. He summarized city-county data book of every county in the country. And he showed when there's more access to firearms, the crime rate drops, in some cases dramatically. Look at John Locke's research. And again, he's using FBI data, uniform crime reports. He's using government data to show these conclusions. Look at Wright and Rossing. There are literally millions of defensive firearm uses every year that you don't hear about because, quite frankly, no crime occurs. They stop that crime. The criminal act is stopped. And so you have to look at those things. One representative, I think it was Representative Hirsch, is gone now, talked about them wearing body protection, body armor and stuff, and saying, well, then you can't stop anything with a 22 or a 38 that someone might have. That's absolutely not true. A headshot stops all that, you know? And it goes back to shot placement. Shot placement is more important than caliber in most instances. So even if they have a 50 BMG, most people might wear vests, maybe even a trauma plate, but I haven't seen a whole lot of them come in with head protection or groin femoral artery protection. So I think the bottom line isn't to me a terrorist attack or anything else, an active shooter that people talk about. It's the day-to-day lives of these students and these employees that I think this bill is about, and this bill of rights should be passed, quite frankly, because it really affects these people's lives every day. It affects the lives of students, it affects the lives of the staff there. And taking away the right to self-defense, making them choose between income and self-defense, is really a horrible, horrible thing. And so I respectfully say this to you, there's tons of data to support what I say. Well, I respectfully again ask you to look at the Clery Act and the reporting that's done every year. And ask yourself if someone synthesizes or if there isn't even still under reporting. But I think even the reports it's done are pretty egregious and really must be considered.
Thank you very much. Is there any questions? Mr. John Martin, followed by Representative Bird.
And I have a question that deals with an issue that nobody seems to have thought about yet, and that's liability. If I'm sitting in a doctor's office, waiting room, and
there's a active shooter incident, somebody comes in and starts shooting up the place, and I'm traumatized either physically or mentally, who is responsible for that? The maker of the gun? The shooter? The one who closed the place as a gun-free zone? Or the police for not responding on time? On me, or just being stupid enough not to carry a gun?
Well, I've got three answers for you. Number one, the United States Supreme Court has said for decades that the police have absolutely no duty to you. So if you come to me and say you want to sue the police, I'm going to say that's a no-brainer. We're going nowhere with that. It just won't happen. They have no duty to you. The second one, I haven't had the opportunity to do yet, but I have instructions from several of my clients who work in gun-free zones. Their employer forbids them from carrying firearms, and they're afraid of their job, so they comply. But they've got instructions to their families. If they're ever killed at work, I'm just sue their employer. And I think that's a good suit. I think that's a good suit that's waiting to happen, because what happened is, but for that employer's rules, that person would have been protecting themselves and would have had what's called the last clear chance. And they don't have that because they're following the rules. I think when you talk about the hospitals, and I think this is important, and I think that they should be forbidden from getting money if they're putting up those type of policies. And here's why. If you talk to what I call the workers, even a lot of the doctors who I've represented over the years in different areas, they don't want that policy. That was fostered on them. Not only to people coming in, but overnight, I had tons of my clients call me saying, I work for Concord Hospital, and we just got this new employee policy emailed to us. And they said, and I noticed buried in between everything is clause whatever that says no guns for us. So what happened was Concord Hospital Administration wanted this. But if you talk to a lot of the doctors and the nurses and the people there who will tell you, as long as they don't think the hospital's hearing them because they don't want to get fired, they don't like that policy because they can't defend themselves either. And so I think there's a suit waiting to happen there because but for their actions, because when a hospital or an employer does that, they really take on a duty to protect you. If they're going to prohibit firearms, okay, they've got a duty to keep the place safe. And I don't think as a practical matter anybody can do that. It's financially not feasible. And so you have to ask yourself, why not give people the opportunity to protect themselves and their loved ones? And I tell people, if you choose not to carry a gun, that's fine. You don't have to carry a gun. That's your right. And by golly, you know, I'll keep mine away from you. But the bottom line is I want the opportunity to save my life. I want the opportunity to stop this. And I really think this is what this bill is about, is a day-to-day action at universities. And it's really a horrible decision because so kids who are between... kids, when I say kids, that maybe means maybe I'm getting old, between 18 and 25, who go out and go to work at wherever they go to work, rather than going to university, they make better decisions so they don't get drunk and have parties and they're going to shoot people? Come on. I really think that the one person who testified is correct in part in that I tell people when you carry a firearm, you actually have to be nicer than you do without one. You have to step back and say, you know, when you're at the grocery store and some rude person jams their cart in front of you to get in line, you back up your cart and say, go right ahead, man. Even though you'd like to say a few choice words about their bad manners or whatever else, you really have to step back. And I say things in my head all the time because I've got quite a smart mouth. I'll say things in my head and with a smile on my face, right? But I won't say what I really want to say to some of these boats. It's like drivers, okay? When people cut in front of you, people give each other the one finger wave. Never do I do that. It's just not worth it. I just sit there and think, that guy's a bonehead. So I think really it makes us more responsible.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you. How do I find more information on the Clery Act? Do I just type in, you know, Google Clery Act, or is there, like, you started off with 20-something?
Yes. It's spelled C-L-E-R-Y, Act.
C-L-E-R-Y,
Act. And it's named after Gene Clery, J-E-A-N-N-E. And it's codified, where you can find the actual law, which tells what they're supposed to report and what they have to report, is in the federal code, United States Code, which is you can find on the GPO website. It's 20 United States Code 1092, F as in Frank. And the specific law basically states in pertinent part
Universities are required to provide a statement of current campus policies regarding immediate emergency response and evacuation procedures, including the use of electronic and cellular communication. And it talks about all the policies they have to include. And it also tells specific crimes they're supposed to report. Murder, sex offenses, forcible or non-forcible, robbery, aggravated assault, burglary, motor vehicle theft, manslaughter, arson, and they've got all these things, and they're further defined. And so those things are supposed to be reported by all universities getting public aid. And it's really a fabulous law in the sense, before that, you still have universities who try and push things under the carpet. I've counseled women who've been raped, who told me they went to the university, and they were basically, they weren't told they couldn't report things, but they were scared out of reporting it. They said, oh, let me tell you what's gonna happen to you if you do this. Do you want, you know, people looking at you, and do you want your name made public and all that? So they're never told, because I'm sure the lawyers counsel them very well, we can't report this. They say, we just want to talk to you first before you decide to report it. And I can tell you, a person has been through something like that, then starts thinking about it, and they don't want to report it then. You know, a lot of them don't, you know, and they all think, you know, we were all drinking, we were doing this, you know, I don't want to get in trouble, someone was smoking a joint. And I think that's a problem, but the larger issue is sometimes you have people who are misbehaving, just like in the real world, that victimize people who are not, who are innocently going about. I know when I was an undergrad, but sometimes classes didn't end until 10 o'clock at night. You know, by the time you walk to your car and go home, and you can't park your car right next to the building, trust me, none of us are that special. You gotta park your car a ways away. And you're really at risk. And so I think, and not only that, employees are at risk. You know, a lot of students anymore have to go to school at night, they work during the day. Employees, the teachers have to teach, the janitors have to clean. So I think this is really a safety issue to your children and grandchildren.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thanks for the clarification. Using your example on the state hospital, if I heard you correctly, you said that people who are committed there don't have access to firearms. That's true, because they're committed there and they're in a lockdown
They're illegal for them to possess.
What was that?
They're illegal for them to possess. If they have been, and in New Hampshire, it's a very unfortunate thing in New Hampshire, if you're committed to the state hospital and you don't commit a crime, you can never get your firearms rights back for the rest of your life in this state. It's a horrible state of affairs.
Right, follow up, Mr. Chairman, please. But that really wasn't the substance of my question. I was just clarifying, getting that statement right. If that's the case, then why bring, when you're visiting, why bring a firearm into that building if in fact the people you're visiting who have mental health challenges or issues, anger issues, whatever, that brought them there, would give them access to that weapon if you're visiting them? Why would you see that as a plus?
I guess the bottom line is I would think that concept is offensive because police with firearms guard them. Why would my firearm be any more accessible to them than anyone else's firearm? I have a right to defend myself. And if you're carrying concealed, someone doesn't know you have a firearm. Most of us don't go around with a sign, my firearm is carried left side strong today, you know, 90 degree can't. And so the bottom line is, just as you're walking to and from your car in the parking lot, when you're walking in the facility, there's no magic cloak of invincibility that's on those facilities. There just isn't.
All right, fair enough. Thank you.
I see no further questions. Thank you very much for your testimony. Brian Blackman.
Hi. If you don't mind, may I stand here?
That is it.
I have just a couple of quick things. I am actually a federally firearm licensed dealer, and I have a problem with some of the wording here that I'm afraid that down the road, if people have their way, the universities may try to start a slippery slope of trying to regulate the sale of firearms. I already answered to the ATF, I answered to the city of Concord. I don't need to answer to UNH about how I sell firearms. So I have a problem with that. I also used to be a co-owner of a security company that managed private dormitories in and amongst the UNH properties as well. And we had an incident one evening where we responded to a location, and one of the students actually was in the military, and he, in his apartment, had an AR-15 and other weapons, and the Durham police responded, and they had no issues with it whatsoever. So it kind of flies in the face with what Chief Dean is speaking to as far as him testifying for the Durham police, because their attitude was totally, totally different than what he had stated. And I think those are my two biggest issues that I don't think I should have to ever down the road answer to the university of them regulating the sale, purchase, ownership, use, possession, transportation, or licensing or permitting of anything that I may legally sell, when I already answered to people well above the university system.
Thank you very much. Any questions? We're going to bounce over the question.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for taking my question. Forgive me if I missed it. Are you for or against the neutral, the bill?
I would like to see this stay as is. The bill. I would like it to go.
So you support the passage of the bill?
Yes.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. Put it on hold.
Thank you, Chairman. Committee Representative Hull of the Town of Bowen, Dunbarton. I'll be brief. A couple things come to mind, because a similar bill had come in to this legislature several years ago. And in talking with citizens who had concerns about the legislation at the time, we discussed whether or not a professor could get on campus. Why did I use a professor? Well, we've got staff members who are in charge of overseeing the classrooms. In the case of the Virginia Tech murders years ago, several professors gave their lives trying to defend the students. So I pointed out that we have people who are responsible for their classrooms, yet we prohibit them from protecting their own lives, let alone the students who are there. Secondly, those who commute to campus, right? The current prohibition in place the way it is means the firearms are going to be left in the car somewhere off-site. They can't be parked on campus property, per se, because of the current prohibitions in place. I strongly believe that the safest place for a firearm to be is on someone's person, not locked up in a car, because there it's under control, whereas in it's right from being taken, and we disarm the person from that car to the campus and all the way back. And people who are commuting, right, graduate students who are commuting in the evening, okay, may be in a job that requires them to carry. They may be a security guard. They may manage large sums of money for a bank or for a small business, and they have to go to the bank. So in all of those cases, we've now disarmed somebody who's a law-abiding citizen. And in the case of the graduate student, or even the professor who commutes in, he wants to be armed on the way into work, right? Has to park off campus. He's disarmed from his vehicle back to his vehicle. But that vehicle is sitting there as an opportunity for someone to steal a firearm, and those are just bad ideas. Lastly, I encourage you guys to go back and look at a University of Nevada case back in 2007. The lady's name was Amanda Collins. She was a concealed carry holder, okay? She was raped in the parking garage. If I understand the story correct, I was not there, I did not see the police report, so forgive me if I don't have the exact representation of what happened. But she was raped within 100 yards of a police officer on campus. That perpetrator then went on to rape two others and finally murdered the third victim. And he was eventually caught. She was armed to protect herself, and the university disarmed her. And that incident may have ended differently. I can imagine a lot of ways it would have ended, but maybe she would have been able to hold him at bay so the police that were relatively close could have apprehended him, and then two other people were raped, and one of whom was murdered, would never have been victims. I ask that you consider the current prohibitions in place have serious unintended consequences. And Alan Rice from the New Hampshire Firearms Coalition said, we believe the law is actually, the current policies and ordinances at the university systems are actually out of sync with the statute. If I read the statute, and I've spoken with attorneys, we don't want that to continue. This clarification eliminates that issue. And with that, I'll close my testimony.
Thank you,
Mr.
Chairman.
Hi, thanks for coming.
Yes.
What was the university for?
University of Nevada. It was 2007, and the lady's name was Amanda Collins. Okay.
I just didn't get the university.
Reno campus, 2007.
Great.
And she has since become a strong proponent as a rape survivor for allowing women to carry on campus.
Thank you.
Other further questions? Thank you very much. That's the end of the pink cards. Is there anyone here who wishes to testify to House Bill 1314? Seeing none, Renee Cushing, would you provide Chairman Thal with a blue team?
Sure.
I will.
We'd like to invite you to visit freekeen.com. Freekeen.com features audio, video, and blogs chronicling the transition to a voluntary society. Freekeen.com also has comments and discussion forums so you can be heard. Freekeen.com.
I should be in Keene, New Hampshire with the Free Staters.